Okay, so thank you again for joining. We're going to keep an eye on anybody else who may be joining after the hour. But it's wonderful to see you here for this session where we will be discussing ethical practice in research data publication, and hopefully in the next hour or 70 minutes, you'll be hearing a little bit more about the challenges, lessons, and opportunities that we are seeing in this space. And we hope that you will also share with us any challenges or issues that you may have seen. I'm Mira Chepuera. I will be chairing this session. In my day-to-day job, I work for AsapBio, a non-for-profit involved in science communication, but I'm also involved with COPE as facilitation and integrity officer. And we are going to have three fantastic panelists, which I will be introducing shortly. And with that, we're going to get started in the conversation around data sharing. I wanted to start with a brief introduction around some of the context for work in this space, and also for some work that we have done, which also involves the panelists here today, in the context of developing recommendations for publication ethics for research data. As you are probably all pretty much aware, there's been quite a bit of interest in increasing adoption for data sharing and publication over the last few years, and supported by a number of initiatives, both by researchers and then communities. You are probably all very familiar with the FAIR guiding principles for data, and also in initiatives to try to develop incentives for sharing and ensuring that researchers who do share data get credit for it. So an example is the 411 data citation principles. Within this context, there has been also an important drive here through funder interest in data sharing. There's been a number of mandates requiring data sharing at the time of publication. And linked to this also, many institutions now have developed programs for training and having support systems for researchers to be able to share the data. At the same time, we have seen a lot of interest in the from the side of journals of publishers. And many publishers have now implemented research data policies, often offering a range of policy options for the journals, some perhaps requiring data sharing and some others less so. But there's been some interest in, for example, the implementation of data availability statements, which again increases transparency around data sharing. The data availability statements ask the authors to indicate whether they are sharing their data with the article, and if that's the case, where the data can be accessed. Another important development in this space was the ICMJE update to its recommendations around clinical trials, and the fact that they actually incorporated now a requirement to have both data statements and data sharing plans at the time of the trial registration. In all of this context, there's been also some work around data policies on the part of COPE, and COPE has participated in a number of conversations in this space. An important thing to highlight is that data policies are actually part of the COPE core practices. The fifth core practice includes a recommendation for journals to have data policies. COPE also contributed to the development of the transparency and openness promotion guidelines, the top guidance, and has also hosted or coordinated a number of conversations and events to allow journals and publishers to discuss research data sharing, data policies, as well as their implementation. An additional item to mention that COPE has also been involved in is that it funded research into data sharing policies at a wide range of journals from different disciplines, and that the outcome of that research was published last year. So essentially, the outcome from all of this, which is a fantastic drive to support data sharing, is that we are seeing more data sets being shared, which is obviously a positive trend. But as we see more data records, we have also started to see more ethical issues associated with data sets. And an interesting aspect here, I think, is that we have also started to see issues that may relate specifically to the research data, but that then we may see items that we need to consider whether there are publication ethics issues related to other outputs associated with that research data. So essentially, we need to start thinking beyond the article only and start thinking about the fact that there may be different research objects that, again, live in different platforms, in different shapes and forms, that all may be affected when we may encounter and ethics issue related to the data set. And this also means that probably we need to have new conversations as to how research object records need to be updated and where needed corrected as well. So in that context, I found myself as well having some of those conversations. As back as 2 years ago, I was a journal editor at the time. Having this conversation on how to handle these different items and how do we work with other stakeholders in this space if there was a case involving one of our submissions to the journal or a publication to the journal. And many of these conversations also involve the speakers today. But what we started thinking of is that if we were seeing these issues and experiencing challenges around this, probably others maybe also experiencing challenges, and that we could actually join efforts and try to develop some guidelines around this that would help us handle this consistently. We thought about early on connecting with COPE, because as all of you here know, COPE has a long-running experience of developing resources and guidelines for journal editors and publishers. And we started this collaboration where we launched the working group, the Research Data Publishing Ethics Working Group, a collaboration between 411 and COPE. We launched this earlier this year with the goal to develop industry-leading guidance and best practices to support the different stakeholders in handling the ethical responsibilities associated with research data publication. One of the things that I wanted to mention that, again, we will be coming back to in the discussion with the speakers is that we wanted to make sure that we were bringing as many perspectives as possible into the conversation by bringing the voices of the different actors in the research data publication cycle. So all the way from the conceptualization, data collection, all the way to publication. And I'm very happy to say that we have the perspectives of researchers, editors and publishers, data repositories and institutions in our working group, which now involves 70 members. So what have we been doing since February? We've been working on our initial set of our recommendations, which we have now released recently. And the way that we approach this is that we initially develop a categorization of the type of issues that we had been seeing, again, informed by the members of the working group, the issues that they had been experiencing, and develop four broad categories of issues. The first one related to authorship and contributorship. The second related to any legal and regulatory restrictions. Third related to rigor, so the completeness or the accuracy of data sets. And the fourth one related to risk, so risk to research participants, society, and beyond. And then what we did is work through all of those categories to try to develop recommendations that would be really be providing practical advice to anybody who may be facing these issues and had to follow up on those, trying to consider different elements that may be useful as part of that process of follow-up. So for example, taking into consideration whether the data set was already publicly available or not, and related to that, whether there were any steps needed to correct or update an existing public record. And then also taking into account this element of there may be different parties involved, because you may have different research objects associated with a single data set. Again, important to consider how does this impact journal editors, but also data repositories, institutions, etc. So I encourage you to have a look at the recommendations. We very much welcome feedback on those. And a few things that more broadly that I also wanted to mention related to that, and again, I'm hoping that we will explore some of this in the discussion, is that a few things that came up in our discussions in the working group that I wanted to share is the fact, well, first of all, as a clarification and a scope, we are here focusing on publication of research data. So that's a step. We know that there may be ethical issues at different steps of the research process, but we are focusing on publication. Something that came up in different conversations is the fact that we cannot just necessarily transpose what we've been doing for journals and publishers to every other actor in the process. Data repositories may be handled differently. They may have different governance and different processes and resources available, and it's important to consider that as well. And also, again, this element of the challenges around communication between different parties, when should that happen? Is it actually even a reasonable expectation to have that we can always communicate with each other every possible object that may be available on the internet that may not always be possible, and that tension between trying to handle the case adequately while knowing that we may not always know about every possible item affected. So having provided that overview of some of the work in this space, the rest of the session is going to be an interaction with our speakers who bring different perspectives to this conversation. And again, I very much encourage you to post questions and comments so that we can feed the conversation. We have a fantastic set of three speakers. Daniela Lowenberg, who is product manager at the data repository Dryad. Jörg Heber, who is research integrity officer at the Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory. And Scott Edmonds, who is the editor-in-chief for the journal Giga Science. And what I'm going to do here is rather than me doing the introductions, I'm going to let them introduce themselves a little bit. So we're going to go in terms, and each of them is going to tell us a little bit as to what the background and context is in the around research data, and also a little bit as to how they came to be in this space of having to handle publication ethics issues specifically for data. So Daniela, we'll start with you. The floor is yours. Great.
Thanks, Aracha. So hello, everyone. My name is Daniela, and I have a couple of different roles in the data world that I may have interacted with some of you on, but I'm here today representing Dryad as the product manager, and I haven't interacted with COPE in about 5 years, but I did work on the data policy at PLOS, so I am familiar with the journal side of things. But again, from the data repository perspective. So for those who aren't familiar, Dryad is a global multidisciplinary repository that's worked closely with journals since its inception in 2009. And through the University of California and Dryad partnership, I began working on the Dryad leadership team in 2018. And so once I started working with Dryad, I started to notice the kinds of cases that were arising that the data curators and team were not equipped to handle. And it became clear that the data repository world desperately needs a resource like COPE, especially since Dryad and other repositories are essential for journal data policies and the future of open science. It felt like a big disconnect that we were relying on journals to handle these issues for us. So Dryad has a team of curators that go through every single data set. So nothing's published until it's been looked at. But what's important to point out is that curation does not mean peer review. So we're not actually verifying the validity of the science or looking at proper approvals for it to be published. So it means routinely we're catching things like identifying information or things with copyright issues and other, which should also ring alarms about repositories that aren't doing curation, not having that capacity. But of course, things are getting published that have ethical and legal issues. And just like a journal article, once the data set is published, it has a live DOI with metadata indexed with data site, public metadata, and it's probably being written into the data statement or a data citation at the journal. And so any changes that we make to the data set after that should be handled in a professional manner. But until now, we didn't have any guidance on that. And so this is kind of what prompted Aracha and I and others to want to really kick off this work. And I want to illustrate some of these examples so you can get an idea of what we've seen on the repository side, keeping them very vague so that they're not identifying. So we had one instance where a person wrote in claiming a published data set identified them and the data set needed to be taken down. It was aggregation of information that had been published on a topic. And so the person's name was used when they were referring to a citation and that person was the author. We went to the legal office at the institution where the author is from and they didn't know what a data repository was, but in the end said that it was legally fine to keep the information online, but that didn't change the fact that the person writing in was still harassing us at the repository. So we really had no standard for how to handle that besides the legal side. Another example is we had a data set that was submitted to us that contained highly offensive material. So archives of the dark web that had conspiracy theories, racial slurs, propaganda, things that really should not be exposed. And it was raw data behind a study that was submitted to a journal about a famous conspiracy theory. So for the data policy, it needed to be made available. We asked the journal if we should make it public, and we really were caught in this middle ground going to different experts about it. But unfortunately, the journal had to take the brunt of this because we as the repository didn't have those resources or advisory boards to go to on it. We only could go to lawyers who said legally it's fine. But again, it really wasn't a legal issue. The last example is that we had data hosted in the repository related to a journal article that made the rounds on Twitter for having incomplete and inaccurate data. And when the journal asked the author for updated data to be sent to us at the repository, they said that the laptop the data were on were stolen, and we had to go to the police at the local police authority that confirmed, yes, the laptop was stolen. And then what was our role as a repository having this incomplete, inaccurate data? There have been no standards on making corrections, retractions, expressions of concerns, things like that are repository. And this is also coming from a repository that has maybe more resources than others. Think about how diverse the repository landscape is. So there are plenty of more of these examples, and folks in the repository world started to think about, you know, how, what is this risk? What is our role in this? And for instance, what about for a disciplinary repository, say a National Science Foundation repository that could be holding climate denier data that's used for policy, but curators wouldn't have picked up on that. So a lot of this comes back to review and whose responsibility and what's the repository role, and really, what guidance do we have here? So we're really thrilled to have engaged in this community effort, really excited that these recommendations are out, and glad that COPE is involved in this. And so interested to hear all of your feedback as journals, and hopefully this kind of builds up proper support for repositories as we support your data policy. Thanks.
Fantastic, Daniela. Thank you so much for giving us this insight into all of the challenges that data repositories handle. I mean, I think it's really informative and also important work in support of open science, et cetera, but all of the challenges that come with it. Wonderful. So we're going to be moving on to our second speaker, Jörg, who is coming more from an institutional perspective, and hopefully you can see my screen as well, but over to you, Jörg.
Yeah, hello. Yeah, it's exciting to be here. I'm representing an institutional view. My own background is also that I've been in publishing for many years. So some of the cases and scenarios that I'm hearing today seem familiar in terms of the themes that are raised. But from an institutional perspective, it's also a very important aspect. And like with any research that's been published, I see the data sets and the related items around that as part of our institutional stewardship of research integrity, at least as research integrity officer for Berkeley Lab. Yeah, it's just like any publication, and we have to handle that in the same way. And one major aspect is also education, training, and awareness. And these are items that we need to raise. We've recently had a survey within Berkeley Lab and asked researchers about some aspects of data and data policy. And we asked them, what license did you have published data with? So that's a very basic question. And then about half of them said they don't know or they're not sure. And sort of that's, you know, even these kind of basic fundamental items can create uncertainty. And so for even amongst researchers, there's very little awareness. And of course, on the other hand, in terms of when problems do come up with data sets, I also feel that institutions can and should be a point of contact in case of problems in the same way that they are for journal publications. And looking at the survey, obviously journals and repositories are the main parties that seem to have addressed these problems, and that's good. But in case of more serious issues or concern with the data set, I feel like research integrity officers like myself also have a role to play in addressing some of these problems. Or if, you know, if data is missing or if there's any concerns around that. And the second aspect is actually that institutions are also hosts of public data sets and repositories. So at Berkeley Lab, we have a facility with several thousands of researchers across a broad range of disciplines. And we have several repositories, subject-specific repositories that are hosted at the lab. And they're fairly, you know, I mean, they're very well known, but they're run by volunteers, by researchers at the lab, and not by professional staff necessarily. So these kind of workflows and guidances that this working group has developed are going to be really important to them. because, as I said, many, many of the subject-specific repositories may not even have the facilities that, that Daniela and Dryad have in addressing concerns. So that's also very important. And coming along with that is also the question, do institutional policies cover all of these scenarios in the right way? So traditionally, research integrity, research ethics has been very much geared towards journal publication. And now the data sets are either published with a journal, at the journal, or alongside it in a repository or independent of it. You know, these kind of policies are becoming very important. And for example, at Berkeley Lab, we've started an initiative to look at our research data policy, and that's going on. And to give you also just one example of the situations that we've come across, a fairly common one is the use of data sets that have been put in repositories. And in certain cases or in certain institutes here at the lab, some of the data gets basically pushed to the repository as soon as it is generated. And it comes with a provision, okay, you should give the main author the opportunity to publish the data in a paper first. And actually our usage policies asks for that. But we had cases where inadvertently other researchers elsewhere scooped authors, users of our facilities with their own data. And that has created concerns. And that's hampering efforts to share data early, because researchers are then not sure, should I share it? Someone may just put my data and inadvertently publish my own research on it. So those again come down to an unawareness of the licensing and conditions under which data is shared. People just, oh, it's on a repository, they see it and then they publish it, or publish on the back of it and generate like meta studies and like broader studies on the back of it when actually the original research hasn't been published yet. So that's just one of those examples that's a bit more mundane, but I think it's fairly common or a fairly common concern for researchers. And that's also something we need to address. So that's around like policies and other criteria.
Thank you so much, Jörg. It's very, very useful to get your perspective here. And I think you raised a very important item there around what you were saying, researcher education as well. I mean, that they don't just share blindly. I mean, probably we need to give them a few more context and resources to also help them progress in this path. Thank you so much. So we're going to move on to Scott now, who again is going to be talking more from the perspective of a journal editor, but also broader because he's been involved in a number of initiatives. So over to you, Scott.
Thanks, Aracha. Yes, I'm here sitting in Hong Kong now. It's pretty late, but I'm trying to be as kind of awake as I can. And I've been invited to kind of wear my journal and specifically data journal hat. Running Giga Science, which has been a journal publishing data sets and sort of data papers since 2012, and a new journal, Gigabyte, that just launched last year that publishes smaller, more granular data sets. But the one thing that we do that's a bit different from other data, you know, other data journals that have increasingly been released by publishers is we have our own data repository and professional curators in-house who will kind of do an audit and check the data before peer review. And, you know, we make sure stuff is in subject specific repositories, but we have our own data repository, GigaDB, that can kind of host all of the stuff that kind of falls through the gap. So we have this wider perspective, and I have a wider perspective than that as well. I'm on the board of Dryad. It's great interacting with Daniela on that. I've helped set up a couple of non-profits and citizen advocacy groups, Open Data Hong Kong, which is now a civic site, and Citizen Science Asia, which does stuff with kind of citizen science data. And I also have a kind of teaching experience, teaching data management and curation at Hong Kong University. So a lot broader than just publishing, but I have 15 years of publishing experience. And I can kind of talk from that side. And from, you know, working in this area and working, you know, pre-data journals, I've interacted and used all of the COPE resources, But from the data publishing side, we were kind of working a bit blind, because, especially a decade ago, these kind of resources were, you know, weren't here. The doing this before the data citation principles and the FAIR principles, for example, we're quite lucky because we are more hands-on. We have professionals looking at this, and we've got levels of peer review. Then hopefully less stuff kind of goes through the, we pick stuff up, more stuff up, you know, pre-publication, but there's still stuff always, you know, slips through, you know, years later, people find errors and the like. And so the things that we've generally seen in this kind of decade or so is, you know, there's obviously a lot of similarities to how you handle publication issues, but with when you're looking at data rather than the bit more downstream interpretation, journals, you know, very much talk about that their thresholds and the like, but data is, you know, as particularly raw data, this is, you know, pre interpretation, and, you know, there's noise, there's some level of kind of inaccuracies in pretty much any data. So even you know, distorted data can be useful if you're clear about exactly what the limitations of use are, if you're very, very clear about what you can and can't do. So because of this, retraction we've generally seen much less retraction than you would for the journal. You may want to retract the journal article, but the data, if you pick up errors with it, if you're very clear about these, you know, you may need to add disclaimers, add some kind of correction or something, but you won't necessarily retract data in the same way. There's a lot more changes to metadata than actual data. At least that's what we and others who were in this working group, a lot of the discussions were on this. And the other big issue we see a lot, and publishing kind of sees this in a way, you know, we've called this, you know, the original working group research data publishing ethics, and we're talking about ethics, but a lot of these issues aren't really ethical issues, they're legal issues, and that is a lot more complicated with data legislation is a lot more kind of strict and in your face and complicated as well. Basically, ethicists can argue till the cows come home whether these policies are even ethical or not. Some countries' data policies, for example, talk about safeguarding national security, but they're not talking about how does this help your populations? How does this, you know, cure diseases that could be cured, right? You could have massive long ethical arguments about this, but ultimately, there's many, many clear legal issues, and you have to deal with them somehow. We've seen it in publishing. A very common example is how do you deal with maps, and this is the same in data. How do you deal with map data when there are you can have submissions from two different countries that will have two completely different policies on the maps need to show this, maps need to show this. You know, they can be on either side of the dotted line. Journals have kind of come to the conclusion, talking to lawyers a lot, that you need to address these neutrally if you can. And so a lot of the legal issues with data are kind of in the same way, without kind of global data policies. And there are some kind of international treaties and frameworks. The Declaration of Taipei relates to health databases and biobanks, and in the same way Declaration of Helsinki kind of, you know, relates to kind of medical research and ethics in that way. We have these some kind of international treaties and frameworks, but generally it's very, very, very local, and this is a lot more complicated. If we see something, the most kind of common issues that we are seeing is you do need to think about, okay, what jurisdiction is everybody in? And there are more players when you are dealing with data, because you've got the actual data producer. It could be a different user from the producer. The repository can be in one jurisdiction. The journal can be in another jurisdiction. You know, there can be many, many legal jurisdictions. And the big question is how do you balance all of these? From a journal perspective, I think that's how we've tried to frame and think about things. And but, you know, before these new data specific guidelines have come out, we'd have to kind of go to the current COPE guidelines sometimes and just kind of scratch our heads and try and think how would this if this was just a paper, how would we deal with this? But we haven't really, it's great. We've got actually better tailored resources to do all of this now. So thanks everybody in the group.
Thank you so much, Scott. And we are always delighted to reduce the scratching. So it's fantastic. But thank you for sharing that experience. I'm going to start asking questions for the panelists, but again, a reminder to please add questions if you have any. And actually, I see one coming up, but I guess I wanted to start first, get my prerogative as chair. I found it quite interesting because I think almost all of you mentioned something that to me suggested that we are seeing a bit of a blurring of roles. So say Scott is involved with a journal that also runs a repository, and you mentioned actually at the institution, they also essentially host data sets. So there is a bit of this blurring of roles, which means that sometimes say, you know, you need to communicate with the other parties, actually the other party, maybe yourself, but you have somebody else involved. So I just wonder if maybe each of you could tell us a little bit about your perspective on that aspect of defining who does what, and if you have any recommendations as to how we can best handle these interactions between parties, because again, this can be very complex. You can have a data set in a repository that is also an institutional page, and then an article and a preprint or protocol, something else. So maybe Danielle, I'll go to you first. Any thoughts on how to best handle those interactions to make sure that it's done practically, I guess, but you know, as comprehensively as it can be?
I think something that's tricky here is that we are going to sound very spoiled as Dread in this context, because we know what the related journal manuscript is because of our integrations, but most repositories don't know what the related manuscript is. And so how do we build a workflow at scale? I don't know what the answer to this is for all repositories to be able to know, like a disciplinary repository or an institutional or even other generalists. How are you supposed to know what journal to get in touch with, especially if the author is not going to tell you and then you're involving the author? The institution is easier to find because most people are, you know, getting the affiliation. But if we're going to rely as a repository on the journal, and most times they don't know the journal, that makes this really tricky. And so ultimately, it seems like we need to have these recommendations and guidance and resources be for a repository or a data journal like Scott's to be able to function on its own and do this. But there also probably needs to be better ways that publishers and repositories are interacting, because there are these cases that we've outlined in these recommendations where, yeah, we as the repository could handle the whole situation ourselves, but it really could affect what's written in the article if it's fabricated data, say. And so I think there's two aspects, which is, are we equipped to be able to figure this out and understand if we should publish the data or not, or post-publication? It's really the pre-publish that's the hard part. Hopefully post-publication, it's easier to find that related article, but not always. It's an assumption that we're going to find out that citation. So I don't know that I have a clear answer, except for there's multiple parts of this that we need to figure out. And step one is probably repositories and publishers working better together in general.
Given that Danielle was referring to journals, Scott, anything to add to that? Also, given that you have the both hats to a certain degree as well.
Yeah, in a similar boat to Daniela, we're kind of overly fortunate that if I have a problem with stuff in our own data repository, I just like, you know, turn my head and, hey, curators, what's happening with this? Right. So we have that communication. But if things are, data is more complicated as well, because stuff can be brokered in many different sources. So, you know, we will take the stuff that falls through the gaps in GigaDB, but then there'll be stuff that in other repositories, and we're seeing it from the journal first. You know, this is coming up in peer review and then stuff. So we're seeing it from the other side from Daniela. But yeah, getting in touch with the repositories the big well-funded ones are responsive, but you know, what would you do if, you know, there are repositories that have closed down, that have lost their funding, that, and they're like, yeah, it's extremely complicated. And as I mentioned before, that, you know, it can be in multiple jurisdictions, there can be language issues. Contacting the institution, the editors who have to handle this, it can, you know, some, if we're dealing with Jorg, it's extremely easy, but you know, there's so many things in other countries that have language issues. They don't have, they, a lot of, you know, and lots of places, universities don't have their, don't really have that kind of infrastructure to kind of handle it. And so, you know, you can see similar with smaller journals, smaller repositories. So yeah, we do need better communication between all these parties, but it's tough. I don't know the answer, but I'm sure COPE has seen these issues in many different contexts. So
always tricky to interact among different parties. But I just wonder what your perspective. I mean, I guess that at least when I was an editor, I was like contacting the institution was a bigger step. But I just wonder how do you see it from the other side?
Yeah, as I said, the institutions need to be receptive to these kind of topics. I also think, in terms of interaction between journals and repositories, I mean, one of the aims of sharing data is that it gets reused and it gets spread out and many people contribute and journal articles may draw resources from many different data sets. So I think there's the one-to-one relationship between a data set and a journal article, you know, that it may becoming less relevant with time. But that also means that repositories, you know, need to have that knowledge on how to handle that, or at least pass it on to an institution. But on the institution side, colleagues of mine, I have the benefit of coming from a publishing background, so I'm fairly experienced with some of these topics. But when it comes to data sets, not every institution may at this point have the knowledge. So I mean, sort of educating institutional contacts is important, and also within our institution, within Berkeley Lab, I mean, we have a fairly collaborative atmosphere. So if a problem comes in with a data set like the one that I mentioned when authors get scooped, which actually led to a retraction, I'm looked in, but also others in the institution, and we provide our own perspective on how to handle such cases from an institutional point of view. So that kind of collaboration is important. I mentioned that having an updated data policy for our lab, and part of that draft will also be like a list of contacts, who to contact for what. So that, because there may be export control, for example, I mean, here at least in the United States, or other topics that may not necessarily legal problems or so on, or intellectual property items on if someone owns a data set that's been published in a repository on our end, so that there's a definite list of who to contact for what, because the range of items that you can see in a data set, it may vary. So we have different domain experts at our institution even. So I think that's also important.
Thank you so much. I'm going to introduce this question from Zoe, who is asking, she's mentioning that they have seen several cases of entire data sets being fabricated. Should we be insisting that all large data sets be deposited in a curated repository such as Dryen? I'm going to start with Daniela, although I imagine, given the reference to Dryen, I can guess a little bit of the answer maybe. But yeah, and also I'm actually going to expand on this because Sue mentions large data sets, but how do you see that? Only for large data sets, what about the big tail of other types of data sets? But what's your initial reaction to that?
I would go back to the fact that curation is not review. So curators can look for different factors to make sure the data are usable and that the data should be published, you know, that there's enough metadata to understand it. But curators aren't going to be doing the validity on it to see that a data set is fabricated. And so a lot of this comes back to that we need peer review to start looking at data. If, especially as repositories, as we're hosting that available, it should be a part of peer review. I know it's a culture change and it's something that, you know, reviewers just aren't doing right now. But that's where you would hope you would find it. And so I think the repositories role, you could verify that it exists. Yeah, the data is there, but you know, it could just be numbers in an Excel sheet and they're really not looking to understand, is this data, is it fabricated, is it not? Of course, they're seeing, is there anything here? Definitely. But I think in general, the answer is data should always go to a curated repository and not in a supplemental file for some of these reasons. And then part two answer is peer review needs to involve data. And then the third part is, then we need these recommendations for what happens if something's published and then we find it.
Very good. Any other thoughts from Jörg or Scott about the use of repositories?
Well, I think in a case like this, when the entire data set is fabricated, I mean, that would fall under our research misconduct policy. That is something at least my institution would investigate for sure in parallel, or, you know, it falls under our jurisdiction as well. Something we'd like to hear about. It may not always be that easy. So we have like data sets in the earth sciences where data is collected globally by like thousands of different volunteer contributors. And then data is extracted from this, papers are being published. But what happens if like one aspect of that, of that data is a concern? Digging into that and across different jurisdictions and different countries and institutions, that may become a problem.
Nobody's invented a authenticate or turn it in for data yet. But as Daniela was saying, you know, curation repositories don't necessarily solve that issue, but it's good practice. You should do it anyway. And having curators, having even peer review isn't guaranteed to kind of pick that up. But the more eyeballs look on things, the more likely some of this stuff will come out of the woodwork. Anyway, it's all better practice. It's the same as peer review for narrative, for everything. It's not perfect, but we're just trying to make things better.
Very good. Thank you so much. I think I'm going to follow up from that, looking at, again, this was an issue of fabricated data, obviously unfortunate, but if we think about this and turn the coin and say, okay, that was an example of bad practice, but the majority of researchers want to essentially sell their work, obviously get credit for it, allow reuse, etc. And they are hopefully trying to do this without getting into any headaches around publication ethics issues. So I just wonder if you had any thoughts as to, again, if we were to give advice to researchers as to how they can best sell their data. We can never 100% guarantee that there won't be issues later, because we cannot control what others in the community may do. But any tips for those researchers who may have this in their mind, how to handle the publication of their data so that, again, they have the best experience possible and potentially minimize any issues that may come up?
Well, I mean, it's almost like a checklist where you have to think about different things. What data do you publish? Where do you publish it? How do you publish it? What license do you use? How is it shared? And all of these kind of things. And fortunately, there's also a solution for how you can think about this kind of checklist, and that's a data management plan. Sort of many research funders now ask that research projects come with data management plans where researchers are asked to consider these kind of questions. And like here in the United States, the NIH is a large research funder. They have a new data policy coming in 2023. They announce it already now and then give people like 2 years time to prepare. And that will mandate things like data management plans and also the publication of data, whether it's associated with a publication, a paper or not. There's a mandate for publication of the data. So that's again an item where repositories are a little bit on their own. But again, they're also mandating a data management plan where many of these kind of things, questions on this checklist should be addressed by a researcher before they even start with their work. And I think that's generally a good practice to consider all these different items and also providing researchers with guidance on how to write these management plans and giving them these kind of checklists, which the NIH, for example, is also doing along with their policy. So I think that's important. And I also asked our researchers how many have data management plans with their project, and right now it's about 70%. So that's already pretty prevalent. And I think that will become standard practice.
Nice suggestion. Thanks so much, Jörg. Daniela, what would be the advice from a data repository?
Agree with Jörg 100%. And have it, if you don't know where to go, look at where you're funding, look at your field. There's a lot of places where that is a norm. Otherwise, if not, then think about where your institution may be supporting. There's a lot of places where it doesn't need to be a barrier because institutions and your funder are already a part of repository communities. And then on top of that, just in general, data should be in repositories and not in supplemental information. I could say that a million times over, but that will help with a lot of these things, especially doing it, ahead of the peer review, making sure that the data citation, all that is linked up. Do it at the submission process and then don't think about it unless you have to make edits to it.
Thank you so much. Scott, any advice from you?
The the FAIR principles for data stewardship is a good, you know, one-stop resource for thinking about data stewardship. A lot of that's been expanded upon, and you know, data management plans sort of take all of that into account. But that was a good kind of grounding on a lot of that stuff, and people kind of use that. So running a data journal, I would obviously say, you know, that's a convenient way to kind of think about a kind of paper shaped kind of package of data. You then work with a data repository like Dryad, or you know, other field specific repositories. You know, they will work with you, give you the curation process will really help you to get that data in a reusable form. And then if you're going in down this kind of data publishing route, then there will be further peer review. And you know, this is all, you know, there's work involved in all of this, but the end product will hopefully be usable, kind of tick all of the boxes in the original data management plan. And you know, it will be in a stable long-term place that you don't need to worry about it anymore, right? At least, thinking about your future self as well, you all of the stuff, it's in your drawers or in some hard disk that you've lost, but it's, you know, this is a usable, hopefully FAIR resource that will have long-term use for other researchers and hopefully yourself. So that's one, you know, that's one way to handle it. Other data journals are available.
Thank you so much. I also, again, a reminder that you can post any questions on the Q&A, so feel free to do that. We have still a bit of time in the session. I'm going to come back to the initial poll. If you remember, one of the questions was about, for those in the virtual room today, they mentioned that for the majority of them, when they had experienced this type of issues, the journal primarily handled the issue, which I guess is not surprising in this context, but I did wonder if, and I guess this is mostly for Daniel and Jörg, whether you, essentially, if there was one thing that you wish journals were doing more or differently and to help with handling this type of situation, when it's specific to data, do you have one thing in mind that you would like to raise for them? So maybe Daniela first.
Yeah, I think when something like this does come up, or something that's happened post-publication at the journal that involves the data, an expression of concern or attraction, a major correction, something, we are never told. We've been told by one journal, and that was once when it went around on Twitter. I don't know that we can spend our resources as a repository trolling or traction watch to see if we have data related to something. So it would be amazing if, when journals do have to handle something post-publication, if it involves the data and a repository is named in the data availability statement or data citations or methods, that the repository is made aware so that we can do the responsible thing as well. And so we've, you know, in the past, I've seen repositories kind of take heat for, well, why haven't you done something? And the repository is like, I've never even heard that this happened. So just, you know, equal responsibility. If we hear something during the publication process with the data or post-pub, and we know who the journal is, repositories should let the journals know, and vice versa, you're probably hearing it first because it's come up, because you're getting more media attention on the article or other. Let the repository know when you can, so that we can make sure that there's the right notice and comment, et cetera, at the data.
Thank you so much, Daniela. Jörg, any thoughts from your perspective?
Yeah, I very much agree with that. And you probably haven't heard much from institutions either. There has been an investigation and some kind of follow-up, usually journals get informed, and yeah, I need to make a note that we make sure that we also inform any repositories. I think that's important. Yeah, as I said, data is not just a part of the journal publication, it's its own way of publishing, so we need to be aware of that, and we need to handle it accordingly and on the same kind of level. Yeah, I also think that, like, ethics, values, integrity items, and like the journal standards that we apply to publications, to journal publications, should also apply to data sets. So that's what I mean. Any kind of policies and practices should include data repositories in the same way that they include journals, and not just as a subset of journal or something that journal has to follow up with the data publisher, but independently. So I think that's very important. And our values on around integrity and ethics and research obviously should cover data as well.
Mm-hmm. So we've covered a little bit this element of it's a recurrent item about the, I guess, keeping the communication channels open between the parties that host the data related research object. I also wanted to ask a little bit for your views as to the responsibility there for the researchers, because essentially they will be posting things in different platforms on these days. Again, we know how the internet works. And as I mentioned at the beginning, I mean, in the working group discussions, this came up several times, saying, "Oh, how can I know if I'm a data repository? How can I know if they have published 3 articles or 2 preprints and protocols, a registered report, all related to this? I mean, am I expected to know all of that?" So I wonder if you have any thoughts as to that element of the author responsibility in this, and if there is any way in which we can raise awareness in terms of giving them some, I guess, responsibility and agency for also leading some of the follow-up if there is an issue. So maybe Scott, any thoughts?
Because a lot of these issues are more legal than ethical, that they there's actually quite a strong driver for a lot of the authors. And if we talk about ethics, it's also sometimes the ethics of we don't want the authors to get in trouble, and they're like some of these regulations, they can get in serious issues. So that there is you'd hope that they are quite driven to address this, at least in those types of cases. It's complicated. Hopefully creating these sorts of COPE resources, the outreach, the education, having good institutional support to kind of teach this stuff. But yeah, it's very hard when there's so many different, it can end up so many different places, and how do you track them all down? I don't know if I can answer the technical side of that. Yeah.
Maybe you're related to this. You mentioned education earlier, so I just wonder if this is something that is, again, in the training programs that you may run, whether it's something that gets raised or anything else that, again, can help researchers in that respect.
Yeah, I'm not so sure right now it gets raised in an adequate way. So that's something we also in the process of reviewing. It's just generally, yeah, researchers just not that aware of some of the legal intricacies of the data. I mean, they're generally aware that you should not publish personally identifiable information. And if that happens, it usually happens by mistake and inadvertently. So I think that kind of education that has worked very well over the last decades. But there's other aspects to it, and those may require kind of information. As I mentioned, there may be embargoes. The license is important, how you license it, how that ties in with your intellectual property and patent application and so on. And then also, it's not just about your own data, it's also about the data of other people that you use in your research. Mm-hmm. And so there's a lot of, there's a lot of concerns, or as I mentioned, some researchers have used data from our facility users without being aware that they haven't really published on that data yet. So you need to be aware what kind of data set you're having, what kind of license it comes with. So if you obtain a data set that's, I don't know, commercially protected and you have a certain license of use, and then you publish that data set in a repository, the actual owner of the data set may not necessarily be happy about this, and then may contact the repository. So making sure that you know what data you use, where it comes from, and under what kind of situations you use it. When I started at Berkeley Lab in December, one of the questions I asked is, who owns the data that's generated at the lab? And it turns out, I mean, that's like a very, very complicated question to ask. So there's a lot of depends on it. But even, researchers should be aware of that, and we are trying to address it by educating them on the answer to that question and other items. Because often they think it's my data, but the owner is someone else.
That's an important point. I think that, as you mentioned, not everyone is aware, and often it's essentially the research is acting as a steward, but actually it's the institution that will own the data. Okay, so
One other point is that, you know, it's the researchers who, you know, what's their responsibility, but the other is that data routinely is CC0, wave of license, because of what you're just said about an institution owning it and that being the correct wave of licensure for it. CC0 data means it can be mirrored anywhere and we don't have to know. Dryad data is mirrored in at least 4 different locations that I can name, and I don't even know how many other places. So if something happens to that data that we need to take action on, we also may not know everywhere else in the world that it's being mirrored at an institutional repository, at others, anywhere. So this is another complexity to try and understand, hopefully with persistent identifiers, is how can we find all instances of something that really needs to be taken down?
Thank you so much for adding that, very important. Okay, so I don't see any other questions in the Q&A, but I wanted to ask all of the speakers one last question before we wrap up the session. And is that we've been discussing the fact that this is a very complex space, many actors, many things still to work out. And again, the fact that we've been having some conversation that hopefully will help a little bit, bring some resources and support and clarity on the handling, but I expect many other things will come that we may not even envisage yet. But I wanted to ask each of you, perhaps again, looking ahead, a little bit about your thoughts on how do you see this space evolving. Obviously, we hope that there will be further data sharing and we're going to see that trend continue. But how do you see things evolving? Again, what would you like to see here? We've covered a lot of challenges and complexities, but I guess that if you had to project yourself from here to say the next 3 to 5 years, how do you see the data space being then? And where will we be in handling all of this? Ethical issues. Will things get better? I guess bottom line. So maybe Scott, starting from you.
So the one trend I've seen in data publishing in the last decade is that because we publish data and we publish software, and it's increasingly blurring between the two in the way that you package up these things are packaged together, and just the rise of AI and machine learning and the like. And so what is actually data and what is computable things is growing, and then AI decision making, so you don't just need the input data, you need the models, how are these trained, all of this stuff is increasingly important, will play a bigger and bigger role in research, in government governance, in policy. And it's even more complicated, right? We only just started addressing data, but 3 to 5 years, I'm pretty certain there'll be a COPE working group on AI ethics. That's where from my futurist hat, that's where this stuff is going, and it's really complicated.
Mm-hmm. Nice item about the AI, because I believe if my recollection of program is not incorrect, that there was a session just this morning as part of this seminar just discussing all of that. So very timely. Daniela, what are your thoughts? How are things going to evolve?
I think this is going to come off as cynical, but I think we're at a pivotal point where if we don't change right now, we're going to be in this exact same place in 5 years in the open data world. And that's because things haven't moved that much in the last few years. And what we really need is for publishers to, you know, support the best practice in the repositories. Please support data citations. They're not being supported right now. It has to happen. If that doesn't happen, we're really not going to have these incentive structures that's going to push it. So I think there's so much we can do right now, like supporting these guidelines, better support between publishers and repositories, better support for data citations, making sure that repositories are now uptaking all of these recommendations and we're doing better on our side. But I don't know where we'll be unless we all decide right now that this is the important part of data, and kind of moving away from this mindset that the really important thing is having a data availability statement. That was 10 years ago, and we need to be focusing on these things like data citation and data ethics and software publishing now.
Thank you so much. Jörg, what's your perspective?
Yeah, I mean, institutions I think increasingly or generally like to share the data. So that's certainly the case for Berkeley Lab, which is an institution run for the United States government. So we like to share the data, and also other research funders like to have nowadays have mandates for the data gets shared. I mentioned NIH, which require that all data is being shared. And that's good because it may also cover negative and null results and other aspects. So there is the willingness and the desire and also increasingly the policy will to share data, but then we also need to equip the researchers with this. I mean, we all have mentioned some of the items and concerns we came across. So we need to make sure that researchers are aware of all the different aspects, caveats in sharing data that come with that and using that shared data. And I think there's a lot of knowledge, there's a knowledge gap there between, you know, what the panels here and others know and are aware of and what the researchers are aware of. And sort of we need to bridge that because it's going to be important as research funders mandate data sharing, which is good, which that's what we like, but we also need to make sure that researchers are aware of those kind of issues.
Right, thank you so much for sharing that perspective. I think the bottom line is that we have our work cut out for us. We are in a path and there is still many steps along that way. But I wanted to thank our three speakers so much for their time today, for sharing their perspective, the challenges that they are facing, how we are having conversations in this space, and also quite a few tips for researchers, editors, and others who may have an interest in driving best practices in this space. So thank you so much to all of you and obviously to our attendees. I wanted, before we close this, to share again the resources from the working group. So hopefully this will come up as it should. As I mentioned, the FOSS 11 and COPE working group has developed recommendations for the categories that we mentioned earlier. We touched on many of the things that we have discussed today with our speakers, also acknowledging where there is issues where essentially we don't necessarily have the clear-cut answer and we should continue having conversations. But the recommendations are available on Zenodo and we encourage everyone to provide feedback. So if you have a look and have any concerns or comments, or you say actually you've missed this, that is very important to me and I work in this space, please do reach out. I added my contact details there, but you can also contact anyone from the working group. The other thing I wanted to mention is that the working group is going to continue its activities. We are not going to stop here. As we've seen, there is quite a bit left to do in this space. We are going to be working on flowcharts to support, again, the step-by-step follow-up for cases. And we are also interested in developing resources that may be useful for the community. So if you are interested in contributing to that, or you just want to at least essentially keep updated of the activities and what we are doing in the working group, you're very much welcome to join it. You can do that on the FOSS 11 website. Okay, and with that, I think we can wrap it up for today. Thanks so much again to our speakers for sharing your perspective and your time today. And I hope everyone has a lovely rest of the day. Thank you so much.
Good night.
Bye.
Thank you.